السلام عليكم ورحمة الله. إن الحمد لله نحمده ونستعينه ونستغفره ونعوذ بالله من شرور أنفسنا ومن سيئات أعمالنا، من يهده الله فلا مضل له ومن يضلل فلا هادي له، وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له، وأشهد أن محمدا عبده ورسوله. اللهم صل وسلم وبارك عليه وعلى آله وصحبه وسلم. Welcome to another episode of Quran in Depth, where we look into the verses of the Quran, reciting them, reflecting upon the meanings of these verses so that we act according to them. That's the fruits of listening and reciting and learning the Quran, is that we act according to what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala wants from us. And when we say act, that means we have something to do with our hearts, with our speech and actions. And that's basically what comprises al-Iman. Al-Iman is all of these things. And therefore we learn how to believe from the Quran, because the Quran, the speech of Allah. So our pillars of Iman, how to believe and what to believe in, based on what's revealed in the Quran and the Sunnah of the Prophet ﷺ, how to worship Allah, what's an obligation, what's haram to stay away from it, what's forbidden for us to stay away from it, and to exalt the orders of Allah. That these are the words of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for us to learn. How to conduct our affairs and how to have manners and relationships. The entire life has to be according to what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala wants from us in the Quran. And the best example is the Prophet ﷺ, which is basically his life is the tafsir, the explanation of the Quran. And Aisha radiallahu anha, when she was asked about the manners of the Prophet ﷺ, she asked the one that asked the question, she said, "Did you read the Quran?" And then she replied, she said, "Kana khuluquhu al-Quran," that the manners of the Prophet ﷺ was the Quran. And one of the things that we learn a lot from in the Quran are the stories of the Quran. And human beings, as human beings, we love stories. And stories has its great effect to the hearts of the people, because it makes us see how things are and how the matter gets repeated over and over again. And there's nothing better than the stories mentioned in the Quran, because it's the truth, the best stories whatsoever. And whatever is mentioned, every single letter of it is benefiting. And it's there for a reason. For the reciter of the Quran at any time, at any place, to learn from it, to believe, to act, and so on and so forth. And this is such an amazing thing for the stories of the Quran, because this is a universal book. This, the final message from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to mankind, for them to live according to the book of Allah till the Day of Judgment. And in Surah Al-A'raf, and this is where we reached, as we see from the beginning of the surah, with the instructions and the talks about the Quran and the hereafter, and what's going to happen in the Day of Judgment between the people of the truth and the people of falsehood. The surah took us to the hereafter to show us the outcome of actions and how the people of Jannah would speak to the people of the hellfire. And then afterwards it talks about stories. And we heard the story of Nuh alayhi salam and Prophet Hud and Prophet Saleh. And now afterwards we hear the Prophet about Prophet Lut alayhi salam, that he was sent to his people in few verses in Surah Al-A'raf. And as we talked about it before, this is not meant for us to just talk about the story of Lut alayhi salam, but we're going through the verses. So the tafsir of these verses in Surah Al-A'raf, the way it's mentioned in the surah, without going necessarily to other details in other surahs that mention the same story of Lut alayhi salam. Each surah has its objectives and the wisdom behind what is mentioned in that particular surah. So we'll do that inshallah ta'ala with also Prophet Lut alayhi salam and his story. And these verses are in Surah Al-A'raf, verse number 80 to 84. From 80 to 84 in Surah Al-A'raf about Prophet Lut alayhi salam. Verse number 80, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, وَلُوطًا إِذْ قَالَ لِقَوْمِهِ أَتَأْتُونَ الْفَاحِشَةَ مَا سَبَقَكُمْ بِهَا مِنْ أَحَدٍ مِنَ الْعَالَمِينَ. Which means, and we had sent Lut, when he said to his people, "Do you commit such immorality as no one has preceded you with from among the worlds?" This is how the verse starts with Prophet Lut alayhi salam. As we saw from the previous prophets, that they were sent to their people calling them to worship Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala alone and not to associate partners with Allah. This is the story of Lut alayhi salam, even though he was sent with the tawheed, with the oneness of worship of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to the people, But the first thing that is mentioned here is about the act that the people of Lut used to do. They did something that humanity never ever knew about before. They've never done the like of it whatsoever. Such an immorality, such an evil act, that the people of Lut are the one that initiated it on the face of earth. So Lut alayhi salam, it was said that he, as it's mentioned also in other parts of the Quran, that he believed in Ibrahim alayhi salam. So he was one of the followers of Ibrahim alayhi salam. فَآمَنَ لَهُ لُوت, that he believed in Ibrahim alayhi salam. It was said that he was related to Ibrahim alayhi salam, the son of the brother of Ibrahim alayhi salam, or the like of this. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala revealed to Lut alayhi salam, sent him as a messenger, and he ordered him to go to the city of Sodom or Sodomy or Sodom, as they translate the meaning of it. So he was sent to a specific town. This specific town, they had initiated this evil act, which is the act of sodomy, and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala sent him to these people to warn them from this evil act, and to warn them there is a severe punishment for them if they do not repent to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala from such an evil act. So the verse says, وَلُوطًا إِذْ قَالَ لِقَوْمِ. Lut alayhi salam, he said to his people, and again لِقَوْمِ, to his people, أَتَأْتُونَ الْفَاحِشَةِ مَا سَبَقَكُمْ بِهَا مِنْ أَحَدٍ مِنَ الْعَالَمِينَ. That he's asking them a question. You are committing, do you commit such an immorality? And what is the fahisha that they're committing? Is this, as it's mentioned in the next verse, the details of it, the sodomy that they used to commit, such an immorality, مَا سَبَقَكُمْ بِهَا مِنْ أَحَدٍ مِنَ الْعَالَمِينَ, as no one has preceded you with from among the worlds. So this is an evidence that this evil crime and this evil sin, it was not present on the face of earth. It's not something that a person can claim that a person is born with it, or it's something in their genes, or what can they do? It's something that is overpowering them. No, it's a choice. We know that it's a choice because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala informed us in the Quran that this is a sinful act. And this is something that all in the previous books before, all of them, they have consensus among this, that this is something that a person would make as a choice. And therefore, it's a lie to say that this is something that a person is overpowered, or it's inside of him, it's something that is in genes and so on. So what is this act? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentioned in the next verse, إِنَّكُمْ لَتَأْتُونَ الرِّجَالَ شَهْوَةً مِّن دُونِ النِّسَاءِ بَلْ أَنْتُمْ قَوْمٌ مُسْرِفُونَ. It says, indeed you approach men with desire instead of women, rather you are a transgressing people. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is saying that Lut alayhi salam said to his people, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala revealed that to him to convey it to the people. إِنَّكُمْ, indeed you, لَتَأْتُونَ, that means you would come or approach, definitely, for sure, no doubt. الرجال, approach men, and you would go to men with desire, شهوةً. That means you desire men, men desire men. من دون النساء, instead of women. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala created men to desire women, and women to desire men. When people change this, and the people of Lut, they were the first ones to change this, in this town that he was sent to call them to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So when people go against the fitrah, go against the innate, go against the orders of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, with such an evil act, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala sent Lut alayhi salam, and exposing this evil act by saying it clearly, that إِنَّكُمْ لَتَأْتُونَ الرِّجَالِ, that you would approach men with desire, شَهْوَةً مِنْ دُونِ النِّسَاءِ. This is something that is not permissible. This is a destructive sin, a major sin. بَلْ أَنْتُمْ قَوْمٌ مُسْرِفُونَ, that indeed you are people that are musrifun. Musrifun, that means transgressors. They transgressed the limits that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala set for us. And therefore, as a result of that, we have limits that we have to observe. And if someone that claims that he has this inside of him, he has to be patient with the orders of Allah. The same thing, if a person has the patience to steal, he should be patient and not to steal. If a person have a desire to steal, if a person has a desire to do whatever haram, something that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala forbade, then a person has to be patient with the orders of Allah and to sacrifice for the sake of Allah. Because the way that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala created this life, He created it in such a way that there are limits for the actions of the people. That's why the messengers of Allah are being sent. And if people transgress the limits, then there are punishments as a result of that. And there are severe punishment as a result of that that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentioned in the Quran. So Lut alayhi salam, he warned these people. And of course he came with the Tawheed, but because of the evil crime that they committed, something that humanity did not know before, so he warned his people and invited them to the truth. And it's mentioned in more than one surah in the Quran with more details in some parts than others to warn against this evil act. Then the next verse, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says about how did they respond to the inviting of Lut alayhi salam to his people to repent to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala from such an evil crime and evil sin. Verse number 82, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, وَمَا كَانَ جَوَابَ قَوْمِهِ إِلَّا أَنْ قَالُوا أَخْرِجُوهُمْ مِنْ قَرْيَتِكُمْ إِنَّهُمْ أُنَاسٌ يَتَطَهَّرُونَ. But the answer of his people was only that they said, evict them from your city, indeed they are men who keep themselves pure. Such an amazing crime that they claimed that the people of Lut they have. وَمَا كَانَ جَوَابَ قَوْمِهِ. That means the only answer that they gave. They did not give an answer of any intellect or any reason or any value whatsoever. The only reason or the only answer or reply they gave to Lut alayhi salam after he advised them sincerely for the sake of Allah, illa an qalu, except that they said to him, akhrijuhum min qaryatikum. Akhrijuhum, that means take them out, evict them from your city. From your city, why? إِنَّهُمْ أُنَاسُ يَتَطَهَرُونَ. They are people, they keep themselves pure. And this is a crime to the people of Lut. They consider this is a crime to keep oneself as pure, which shows that the opposite of it, or to be impure, is when a person commit this evil, immorality, this act of transgression, transgressing the limits of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. إِنَّهُمْ أُنَاسُ يَتَطَهَرُونَ. It's amazing then when the crime of a person is because he's pure, that he's clean, then people would evict him from their town, from their city. And this is in this context, it's clear of how these wrong and evil relationships that the people invented, and they would establish their life based on this, and how Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala warned them against it, and how that a person should stay away from what is haram to be pure. And it shows that when a person commits a sin, it's basically, this is the act of impurity. Impurity is when a person disobeys Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. The Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam, he informed us that half of the religion is at-tahur, to be pure. To purify oneself, this is half of the religion. And the other half is to adorn oneself with whatever is pure and good. So to purify oneself physically and our hearts to be purified, and to be purified from sins and disobeying Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, this is half of the religion, and one of which is to purify ourselves from such evil acts. And without going into explicit ways of describing things, but it's something that a person with normal being and instinct in one's heart would see how evil of a sin that is for people. They need to repent to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And people should invite others to repent to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and to stay away from sins. Otherwise, they bring the wrath of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala unto themselves. We'll continue, inshallah ta'ala, with more of the story of Lut alayhi salam with the verses in Surah Al-A'raf, but right after the break, so stay with us, inshallah. Muhammadur Rasulullah. Muhammadur Rasulullah. Alhamdulillah, salatu wassalamu ala Rasulullah. Welcome back. And with verses from Surah Al-A'raf, verses number 80 to 85, about the story of Lut alayhi salam and his people, and the struggle that he went through to invite his people to purity, to purify themselves from disobeying Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala with such an evil act, where, as it's mentioned in the verses, where men approach men with desire, and they would not do that with women in the legal way, in the halal way. And we see that how Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala created the human beings in such a way that he created Adam alayhi salam, and he created his wife to be with him. And from Adam and his wife, all of the offsprings of the human beings came. And it's been the practice of all of the human beings that the men, they marry the women, and this is how they fulfill their desires, both, and the offsprings, the families, and one generation after the other, till the people of this town, as Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentioned them in the Quran, they invented this evil act, invented it, something that was not known among the human being, where men approach men for desire and not women. As a result of that, as we know, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala destroyed them, punished them, as the verses are mentioning. But how Lut alayhi salam, he was sent to the people, calling them, inviting them, and having the leniency and the gentleness towards them, to for them to repent to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala from such an evil act that bring the wrath of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala upon the people and the punishment of Allah. We know that this is the case with all of the sins. Sins are basically destructive to nations and to people. They destroy themselves. And if a person lived a healthy life and people see that there is nothing wrong with them, even though they're upon sin and transgressing the limits of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the real unhealthy life and impurity is when a person pollute himself and contaminate himself with disbelief, with associating partners with Allah, with being defiant against the orders of Allah, going against the pure nature that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala created us. And then if a person does not repent to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala after the truth has been conveyed, thereafter there is the hellfire, severe, painful torment from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is the most just. The message is conveyed, the truth has been made clear, and if a person doesn't take the truth and doesn't accept the truth, then they should not blame anyone but their own selves. So this is what Lut alayhi salam, he said to his people, and he conveyed the truth to them, and he invited them to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is the most merciful. He forbade this evil act for them to live a pure life, for them to live a goodly life. But instead of them accepting this truth and the message of Lut alayhi salam, they rejected it, and they even went far to say that, evict him and his people from your town. Why? إِنَّهُمْ أُنَاسٌ يَتَطَهَرُونَ, that indeed that there are people that they keep themselves pure. And as we see how purity becomes a crime at certain times or certain situations, you know, which is makes it very deceiving, how that the truth becomes falsehood and the falsehood becomes the truth. When a person lives a time where the principles become something that a person has to prove to the people. You know, for example, for us as Muslims, we know the pillars of Al-Islam. We know the pillars of Al-Iman. We know the major sins that no differences whatsoever among the entire Ummah, one of which is this crime that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentioned, the sin that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentioned about the people of Lut. There's no differences whatsoever. And then someone would come and say that this is something that what can people can do, this is something that, you know, it's okay, it's not a sin. There's a major difference between approving what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala forbade and someone commits a sin. This is major. This can lead the person to disbelief when a person deny what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala approved as a sin or whatever. So this is what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in the Quran. And this is how Muslims should be firm upon matters of the deen, and not to change the religion, and not to have any fear except the fear of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and to have the proper conduct and the proper way of living with the orders of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and to hold fast to the deen of Allah, and a person to continue to be in the state of purity. So when he said, you know, when the people said to the people of Lut to be evicted from the town, إِنَّهُمْ أُنَاسٌ يَتَطَهَرُونَ, and we'll talk about at-tahara and purity at the end inshallah ta'ala. Then after that, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentioned that the punishment of Allah came to them. Here in Surah Al-A'raf, it's mentioned briefly. In other parts of the Quran, it's mentioned with some more details. But verse number 83, this is the next verse, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, فَأَنْجَيْنَاهُ أَهْلَهُ إِلَّا امْرَأَتَهُ كَانَتْ مِنَ الْغَابِرِينَ, which means, so we have saved him and his family, except for his wife. She was of those who remained with the evildoers. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala saved Lut and his family. It was said that only the family of Lut, they were believers. As Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentioned that in Surah Al-Dhariyat, that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala sent Lut alayhi salam and sent the angels to to Lut alayhi salam with the punishment of his people. Here it just says فَأَنْجَيْنَاهُ, we saved them. But in other parts of the Quran it says the details of what happened, and the angels were sent in the shape of men, in the image of men, to Lut alayhi salam, and they were his guests. They were the guests of Ibrahim alayhi salam, and then they informed Ibrahim alayhi salam that they are going to the people of Lut, and how the wife of Ibrahim alayhi salam, when she left as a result of this, because she was happy that the punishment is going to the people of Lut, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gave her the glad tidings of her son. And the stories are mentioned in the Quran. So the point here is they went to the people of Lut. And Lut alayhi salam, this was a very difficult time for him, because these angels, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gave them the beautiful appearance. And as we know that the people of Lut, the men approached the men with desire and so on. So the people of the town, they came to him. They came to Lut alayhi salam desiring the angels, those who were in the shape of men. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentioned this in the Quran. And Lut alayhi salam had difficult times, but the angels, they conveyed the message to Lut alayhi salam that they will be destroyed and their time is in the morning. And they saved Lut and his family, and they were evicted, basically, as the disbelievers, they wished for them to be evicted. They left the town safely, and the punishment of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala came to the people of Lut as a result of their evil actions. فَأَنْجَيْنَاهُ وَأَهْلَهُ إِلَّا امْرَأَتَهُ كَانَتْ مِنَ الْغَابِرِينَ, except his wife. His wife was the only one from his family that was not saved, because she was among the disbelievers, that she was with them, approving their actions. Even though she is a woman, she approved their actions. She would plot against her husband Lut alayhi salam, and she allied herself to the people of this great sin. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentioned that in the Quran, also in Surah At-Tahrim, as a sign from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, how Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala created the way the creation and the human beings are in such a way, and to give it as an example, that some even prophets of Allah, the best men ever walked on the face of earth, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala made to some of them their wives, they betrayed them. Betrayed them meaning that they were disbelievers, as the wife of Nuh alayhi salam and the wife of Lut. And they were the wives, and فَخَانَتَهُمَا فَلَمْ يُغْنِيَ عَنْهُمَا مِنَ اللَّهِ شَيْئًا, that the prophets, which is their husbands, did not avail them. This is the wife of Lut, and she was among the disbelievers, and she's among the people of the hellfire. It did not benefit her, the fact that her husband is a prophet of Allah, which shows that each person has to earn it themselves. And no one will bear the sin of another, and no one will benefit necessarily from his lineage if he is a disbeliever. It's only benefiting if a person upon belief and upon righteousness. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said that the only ones that were saved are the family of Lut alayhi salam, except his wife, كانت من الغابرين. She was among those who were punished, like the people, because of, again, as we see here, not just those who would act and do the evil act, but also those who approve the act, those who would believe that it's permissible. They subject themselves to the severe warning from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and the punishment of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And then after that, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentioned how they were punished, which is the next verse, verse number 84. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, وَأَمْطَرْنَا عَلَيْهِمْ مَطَرًا فَانْظُرْ كَيْفَ كَانَ عَاقِبَةُ الْمُجِرِمِينَ, and we rained upon them a rain of stones, then see how was the end of the criminals. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala rained, وَأَمْطَرْنَا عَلَيْهِمْ مَطَرًا. It was said in other parts of the Quran, and also with the hadith of the Prophet عليه الصلاة والسلام, that the towns of the people of Lut, it was lifted all the way high in the skies, to the extent of which, as the Prophet ﷺ said, that the angels would hear the barking of their dogs. And then it was flipped over, they were smashed on the earth. And then it was rained down upon them, rain of stones following their falling from above. This severe punishment that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala punished the people of Lut as a result of their evil act. وَأَمْطَرْنَا عَلَيْهِمْ مَطَرًا فَانْظُرْ كَيْفَ كَانَ عَاقِبَةُ الْمُجِرِمِينَ. فانظر means then see, and that's an order from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for the Prophet عليه الصلاة والسلام and the ummah of the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم to see and to reflect upon this. See كيف كان عاقبة المجرمين, how was the end of the criminals. They were مجرمين, they were criminals, they transgressed the limits of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and this is what criminals are all about. When people have rules and someone transgress the limits and commit crimes, they are considered to be criminals. So the same thing when a person transgresses the limits that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala set for the people, they are criminals, especially that they initiated this evil act that came after them, and it become in the balance of their bad deeds, basically their evil act that they initiated. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is the most just, and He is the most powerful subhanahu wa ta'ala. Nothing is the like of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Because of the severity of their actions, the severe punishment came to them in this life and in the hereafter as a result of their evil action. That's why this is a story that we should reflect upon, and especially that we're living at times when things are very confusing to many people, and many of those who they are upon the truth, they're not conveying the message of advice and sincerity and goodness to the people by showing to them what is right and what is wrong. And if people have the sincere and the pure concern towards people, He would warn them from the evil that they are bringing to themselves. And you know, sometimes when evildoers, when they do something evil, they would block the ways of people to advise by claiming that the people, those who advise, they are harsh, they are threatening, they are being not accepting others and the like of these statements. But for a person to see the truth, you know, there's differences between knowing what is right and what is wrong and the limits that a person has. But definitely this is something that an individual should advise others if he has the means, and to be firm upon the truth and to warn against this evil sin that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala warned from it, that it brings the wrath of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala unto nations. It brings the wrath of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala unto people when they commit this evil crime. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is the most merciful. And that's why when we look into this, when we look into the story of Lut alayhi salam and how it's mentioned in details in the Quran, and how he was patient with the people, and how he was given so much of the patience and the kindness and the goodness, and when he said to the people and conveyed the message to them to go back to their innate and to be obedient to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and not to commit this evil crime, instead of them accepting the truth or being patient with the orders of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, they asked or they ordered for Lut alayhi salam and his people to be evicted from the town. For them, the reason why, it's because they are people of purification and purity. And this is what we need to reflect upon. إِنَّهُمْ أُنَاسٌ يَتَطَهَّرُونَ. Indeed, they are people of purification. How this was established in the deen of Allah, in the final message of the Prophet ﷺ to all mankind, this inshallah ta'ala we'll talk about after the break. So stay with us inshallah.
محمد رسول الله محمد رسول الله
الحمد لله والصلاة والسلام على رسول الله. Welcome back, and we are in Surah Al-A'raf from verse number 80 to 84 about the story of Lut alayhi salam and his people. It's mentioned briefly in Surah Al-A'raf. It's mentioned more details in other surahs of the Quran. And as we heard before, that it's meant to be like this in the surah, one verse after the other, one story after the other, and a set of prophets that are mentioned in the surah for people to see the way of the messengers of Allah. It was the same way, the same message, the message of Tawheed, calling people to the oneness of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and also warning people against the evil actions, that it should be something that is abhorred by all of the human beings when it comes to one's nature. Some of the forbidden acts or sinful acts, you would find it in some nations different than other nations, or at certain times it was forbidden, and then in other ways of life or prophets of Allah, it was made permissible. And this is something that you can see in some other things. For example, at the time of Adam alayhi salam, the first generation after Adam alayhi salam, it was permissible for the brother to marry his sister, because these are the only human beings on the face of earth. So this was permissible then, but then it became something haram, something of a sinful act later on. So it shows the, as a principle. And also in the final revelation to the Prophet ﷺ, some things that might not be present in the previous prophets, and this is because the final revelation from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is so universal that encompasses everything and it fits all of the human beings. But as you see, these sins that are mentioned in the Quran with regards to the previous prophets is something that continued to be the same till the final messenger Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam. And that's why even we would see among the people of Madian how their prophet Shu'aib, he called them to La ilaha illallah, to worship none but Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala alone, and also warning them against cheating in the balance and having bad conduct in buying and selling and deceiving people and so on. This is something universal, something that people all over the earth, they would hate so much for someone to deceive them and to be in such a conduct of stealing and deceiving people with the balance when they're purchasing something or whatever. So this is something that is universal. The same thing with what's mentioned about the people of Lut. And that's why what's universal, and it's mentioned by the Prophet Lut alayhi salam, and how their people, they ordered Lut alayhi salam to be evicted from the town. And the reason why they mentioned this, إِنَّمْ أُنَاسٌ يَتَطَهَرُونَ, they are people of purification, they pure themselves. And it's so amazing that this is something that's supposed to be universal too. For human beings, they love purity. If you translate this word to whatever language on the face of earth, people love the word purity, purification, tahara, something clean. Nobody likes something to be dirty or to be not clean and so on. This is in the fitrah, in the nature of the people. When people start to like what is not clean, that means they're going against their innate. They're going against the way that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala created them. Sometimes people, they use the word which is not pure, to be impure, to be dirty. They use this word as a way of praising someone, in a sinful act or something like this. This is how the human being can degrade themselves. And that's why a Muslim should protect himself from any form of impuring oneself or impurities or having contaminations of anything that is, whether it's physical or non-physical. And that's why these types of sins, a person has to be careful how he's raising his children and how Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala created us men and women. This is the creation of Allah. And how Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala revealed verses to the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam with regards to marriage and establishing marriage in the right way and rulings about this and so on. And it's the rights of a human being, a child. He has the right to have a mother and a father. And that's why the orphan in a Muslim society is someone to be given more and extra attention. Why? Because he lost his father, or if a person lost his mother and so on. So this is the normal way that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala created us on the face of earth. And this is the purification. And this is what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala wants from us. But when a person is raised to have this matter confused, especially how human beings, they get affected by one another and with the environment that they live in. And that's why when we say in schools and our gatherings and so on, there's separation between men and women, because this is how Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala wants us to conduct our life and for people to purify themselves, men to be raised as men, or boys to be raised as boys and men, and the girls to be raised as girls. And the girls, they do the girls' things when they're in school, when they're young, and the boys, they do what boys, what's very unique that makes them different, and this is something very clear for any person that is in the school system or upbringing. There are differences. How Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala created us different, not in everything, but in the things that makes us unique. This is something that part of the deen of Allah is to purify ourselves, to continue to be upon the nature and the fitrah that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala created us with. So the issue of the tahara, or the issue of purification, which is half of our religion, we see that in matters of belief. When Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala ordered us to purify ourselves from shirk, from associating partners with Allah, to purify ourselves from disbelief. This is a way of purifying ourselves. The belief, which is the place of it, is in the heart. We have to adorn our hearts with all of what is good and pure, and to push away all what is sinful and impure. And that's in matters of belief, as we heard, also in matters of ibadah. Half of the salah, our prayers to be established, that we have to be in state of wudu, and that's a state of purifying ourselves. So purification, this is half of our deen, because you would find that you have to clean yourself, you have to purify yourself. When a person goes to relieve himself, we cannot leave impurities. We have to clean ourselves to be clean when we interact with others, when we worship Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. It's a beautiful thing to be clean. When a person is eating, for example, to eat with our right hands, these are the etiquettes that the Prophet taught us, and something that children to be taught such an act, to eat with the right hand, to clean themselves with the left hand, so that people do not feel uncomfortable with one another. They know that a Muslim is clean. When they eat with a Muslim and they eat together from the same plate, they know that the Muslim is clean. Why? Because his right hand does not touch impurities. It stays away from impurities. This is how a Muslim would abide by these etiquettes and these ways of living. The same thing when it comes to our speech. There's some speech is pure and some speech is impure and evil. When a person, you know, say bad words and revile others and the like of this, this is all impurities. This is all sinful. So it's basically the sinful life that a person lives. His life is a life of impurity. And why would a person want to live in life of impurity? And as we mentioned before, the example, as Ahmed, they give it, when a person's, you know, life has been drinking from a dirty cup, a cup that has been contaminated so much, you put water in it, the water is not clear. The water is so, dark, that, you know, gives different colors. And the person, this is the only water that he knows in his life. And it smells bad, it looks bad, but he keeps on drinking it because it's an essential thing in his life. So imagine this person, if someone had given him the attention that this cup needs to be cleaned, or the water needs to be purified. And then when he cleaned the cup, and then finally he put pure water in the cup, and then he drinks, he would see to himself, I wasted all of my life. It was not life, it was miserable when he was not drinking the pure water. So this is a totally different level. And sometimes people, when they're immersed into whatever is evil, they don't know what is good. And they would even attack the people of purity because they did not taste purity yet. So that's why the people of purification, they should be patient with them and calling them, inviting them, and showing the truth to them that the way of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is the best way. And not to follow our desires on the face of earth, but rather to follow what is true. And what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala revealed to the Prophet of Allah is what's true. And life is based on such a way that not everything that we desire happens on the face of earth. Some people, they lose their eyesight. Some people, they lose their arms. They lose health and so on. And they're ordered to be patient and to be pleased with the orders of Allah. So if a person says that this is what he desires, and it's a sinful act, be patient with oneself. And repent to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And turn to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and make dua, supplication to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to take oneself away from these evil acts that corrupts one's perception and one's belief and takes the person one step after the other to live such an evil life and miserable life away from the orders of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And that's what we see what happened to the people of Lut. And the same thing would happen to those who follow the same act, not necessarily on the face of earth as it happened to the people of Lut, but it's a message and a lesson for us that even if they continue to live a life where they follow their desires and so on, the moment of death comes. And when the moment of death comes, when a person is upon evil actions, we saw what happened to the people of Lut, and we see what happened to those who disobey the orders of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So in these verses, how Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentioned the aqibah, and how the characteristics of the people of Lut, and how they are musrifun, they are transgressors, they transgress the limits. We should fear Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and not to transgress the limit. How Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala called them and ordered us. And one of the great benefits to learn that we are ordered to look into the outcome of actions. فَانْظُرْ كَيْفَ كَانَ عَقِبَةُ الْمُجْرِمِينَ. Don't be limited to the time that you live in. It's only good to limit oneself in the time that we live in if we're thinking about the past to bring the sadness and the miseries, or when we think of the future out of fear or concern, or to be stressed what's going to be our provisions and wealth and so on. This is all not good. But rather a person should focus on the time that he lives in so that he does not waste it, so that he is worshipping Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, fulfilling the orders of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. But what needs to be done when it comes to the outcome of things and to look to the future is for a person to see the outcome of one's actions. What Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala always calls us to see the aqibah. What is the aqibah? People might be enjoying their life, enjoying their sinful sins and so on. But what's going to happen to them after this life? This is what a person's heart should be attached to. And this is the concern should be when a person invites to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and to the orders of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And this is how the believers should be having this comfort and this settling feeling that we need to be obedient to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wasallam, and to purify ourselves. We need to be in a state of purification by pushing away the evil, by showing the evil to feel that it's evil. That's why one of it is to stay away from these environments. Stay from the environments that makes the evil as something normal in the life of the people. Many of the Muslims today, in whatever environments that they're in, they suffer a great deal because of how their children has been affected so much and they've been changed. They act in a different way. They don't look like Muslims, they don't act like Muslims, they don't have these values that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala wants from us. Because when a person puts his own self and his family into this environment, what a person can expect? When the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam, he said, لا تصاحب إلا مؤمنا ولا أكل طعامك إلا تقي. Do not have friends except a believer, and do not make anyone eat your food except the taqi. You can invite others to your food, you can invite non-Muslims to your food and so on. This is something that the Prophet ﷺ did, but the hadith is talking about the friends, those who are very close, those who you see all the time, you see on a daily basis. Who are the ones that we're seeing on a daily basis? And we have to make sure that we protect ourselves. We should not say, well, that's the life that we live in. No, we have to abide by the orders of Allah and to be patient, to protect the most valuable thing in our life, which is the religion of Islam, which is the religion of purity, for a person to have a pure heart and a pure conduct and actions and so on. We ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to guide us to the truth and to make us hold fast to the truth and to push away harm from us. And we ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to make us learn from what we heard and the verses of the Quran. Until next time, I leave you with the protection of Allah. Wa sallallahu wa sallam wa baraka ala Muhammadin wa ala alihi wa sahbihi wa sallam. Wassalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.
الذين تابوا وأصلحوا وبينوا فأولئك أتوب عليهم وأنا التواب الرحيم.
فادعوا الله مخلصين له الدين ولو كره الكافرون.
يا زكريا إنا نبشرك بغلام.
شاهدا ومبشرا